My name is Lindsay Walz, and I was driving southbound heading home to Minneapolis when the bridge collapsed. My car was in the left-hand lane, and I thought about getting off at the university exit, the exit right before the bridge, but felt like it was too much trouble and hassle to try to budge in between cars as it was stop-and-go traffic. My car kept inching along across the bridge until we got to the middle of the bridge. And that's when a beam snapped and my car started to nosedive into the Mississippi River. I was in the middle section of the bridge, I would describe. I might have been a little bit further one way or the other, but I was in the left-hand lane, just kind of inching along, waiting for cars to move in front of me so that I could get home from my long day at work. I was coming from a day of work. I worked in Shoreview at the time, working with youth in teenagers in a group home, helping them to support them with emotional and behavioral needs that they had. I was an independent living skills instructor there and was working with kids who were aging out of foster care and kind of transitioning to adulthood. And that particular day, I had been teaching them about budgeting, which is not a fun set of skills. Most adults don't even want to do that. But I was really looking forward to coming back the next day because we'd started a big kind of mock budget thing where they were going to be kind of getting paid by me and then paying bills to me, and it was going to be this whole thing that happened throughout the coming month every day. So I was really looking forward to coming back the next day and was kind of in la la land, so to speak, as I was driving home that day, thinking about the days ahead and how excited I was that the kids had been kind of interested and excited in doing that work with me. In my experience, I heard a sound. I heard a very loud metal sound. I thought something very large and very metal had maybe dropped, had snapped, had something. And my only thought prior to falling was, oh crap, somebody messed up. And I for that split second, I figured a construction worker had dropped something, something bad had happened. But I didn't have any other indicator that anything, my car just started to free fall. So I don't remember exactly where they supposed that I was, but I kind of assumed that I was right over the gusset plate that broke because my car just started to nosedive into the water. I didn't really anticipate the water though. I mean, somewhere in my head I knew that I was driving over water, but I kind of just imagined that my car would land on the concrete and that my body would be in a million different pieces once I stopped moving. And that's not what happened. Luckily, I landed in the water, but that led to kind of my second survival experience, and that was drowning in my car. My car did a nosedive, so as the car went into the water, water came up into my car at the exact same rate. It wasn't like those fun TV shows wasn't those fun news stories that they had after the fact, like how you survive if your car goes in the water. That's not what my experience was. It was car is full of water at the same time that the car stops moving and hits the bottom of the river. So I didn't know what to do. My only instinct was to unbuckle my seatbelt and to start pushing on surfaces, hoping that something had given way, some window had broken, the door had gotten dislodged, something. And so I have this very clear memory of unbuckling my seatbelt and starting to push. I pushed on everything. I didn't know what I was pushing on because it was murky and dirty water. So I pushed and pushed and pushed, getting disoriented the whole time. I know at one point my body went into the back seat because it went over the seat. I could feel that. I was getting turned around. And at some point, my body started to have the instinct to gasp. I held off on that instinct as long as I could, but at a certain point, there's just no fighting that any longer. And so I started to swallow water. I had the instinct, I think, to swallow the water instead of inhale it. And I did that three or four times, and each time that happened, I kind of was shifting my thinking away from, like, how am I gonna get out of this? Because I knew nobody could get me out. I knew there was no physical way for somebody to get to me. And nobody would even know that I was there until I was gone. And so I was really shifting from, how can I get myself out of this, to how do I just accept that this is it? How do I say my goodbyes? How do I replay my life and take stock of things? How do I live with what I've lived with? And started to accept that that was it. Started to shift from fighting to accepting. And at that same time, my body had stopped pushing. It had stopped moving around, trying to find a way out. And I thought that was it, and I was just waiting to die. And then you get all of those images of what it means to die, right? All of the pop culture, what happens in the movies. I had the visions of the ghost movie playing through my head, of bright lights, of all that stuff. And I felt a bright light, or I saw a bright light. And the next thing I knew, I was floating. And I thought, okay, well, this is it. I'm dead. And I knew I was beyond the confines of my car. I knew I had moved past where I'd been trapped. And I was in my body still. It felt like I was in my body still. So I kicked to the surface of the water and hoped that I was still alive, and reached the surface, and then saw what was going on above the water. And I was alive. Once I surfaced, I was turned around. I was facing the falls. I had to reorient myself to where the bridge was. I was probably about 10 feet away from the bridge. And the first, I was just dumbfounded as to what had just happened. And then was aware that, like, I'm still not sure I'm actually alive right now. So I started to make some noise, and a construction worker who had fallen with the bridge, Jeff, he saw me, which was a huge thing to be seen. He encouraged me to swim over to where he was on the bridge. There was a section that was a little bit easier to climb out of. There was a broom nearby. He grabbed the broom and used it to fish me out of the river. He told me to go sit by the median and wait for help. So I did. I'm a very good rule follower. As I was sitting at the median just waiting, it became really clear that I had pretty significant injuries. My back was starting to hurt and cause me excruciating pain. I'd never experienced that kind of pain before. And I was, starting to worry about, like, maybe I'll be paralyzed, like, my back feels broken, something's wrong here. So I sat there, and I think I sat there for about 45 minutes, just wiggling my toes, watching what was going on around me. At one point, another survivor who was wearing scrubs at the time, Amy, she came up to me and assessed me, and at first I thought she was a helper, somebody who hadn't been there, but she was a helper for sure, but she had been there and fallen herself. But she was the first one to notice that I was bleeding. I had some scrapes on my hands, on my legs. She called for across the median to the northbound lane of traffic, asking for a bottle of water and a towel. Does anyone have a bottle of water and a towel? And within like seconds, a bottle of water and a towel came flying across the median, which just like struck me as just so Minnesotan, like, so everyone's just there for each other. I remember getting out of the river and seeing the, I guess I've come to call like the Island of Bridge, and seeing people on the northbound side standing outside of their cars on their phones. And I was so confused because I couldn't understand how they were just standing there, and how, you know, it just looked like they'd ridden the bridge down, like that their car had been glued to the cement. I learned later that that wasn't the case, that they had flown feet, you know, hundreds of feet one way or the other. They definitely didn't land where they had started. But it was just so surreal. And that's like that area in that little bubble. Everyone was just, I can't often think of it as just like this quiet, like shocked silence. Everyone was like, there was some talking, there was some stuff, but everyone's just so stunned. I'd driven that bridge many days over the course of that summer, and there had been some times that I had thought, like, this seems weird, like the way that they were doing things. I'd never seen them like remove surface on a bridge that's suspended so high. I think there was a point where I could like see through a section, like the part that you weren't driving on, but you could like see through it. And I remember thinking, like, this is not good. Like, this doesn't seem right. I think the scariest part was the fall. I think it was, because it was like, 1 second I'm just a normal person driving home from work, excited to go home and have dinner with my boyfriend, and the next second I might be dead. And that fall was, it lasted forever in a certain way, like it never stopped. And it's still something that I can feel in my body. Like if I watch something happen on TV or in a movie or somebody's falling, like my body feels that gravity and that G-force. So I had a broken back. I was in the hospital for 5 days and spent 5 months in a back brace, which was very painful in lots of different ways, really uncomfortable. But that wasn't my biggest injury. My biggest injury was post-traumatic stress disorder that continues to affect me. I've learned a lot of skills to calm my body down when it gets freaked out, but it's still alive and well in my body. And PTSD impacted me in lots of ways. Like I had been working for this group home, and one of the things that you have to be able to do in that kind of a setting is to really not have your armor up, but just really be emotionally balanced and content, like just be really aware of your own emotions. And that's something that I had been really good at beforehand. And then I had a medical leave, and once the doctor cleared me physically to go back, I quickly learned that I wasn't emotionally capable of being in that environment. I started crying for like just out of nowhere for no reason necessarily. I had no sense of my own emotions. I felt like a zombie in a lot of ways for a very long time, especially as it relates to the bridge. I had lots of sideways emotions. I'd get angry about things. I'd get frustrated. I'd cry about things out of frustration. But like thinking about what actually happened and grieving for that, grieving for the loss of life, grieving for all of the people who've been affected, isn't something that I really could even begin to do until 5 years after it happened. I've really, over the last few years, tried to focus on the things that bring me happiness, the things that bring me joy, the things that make me feel most alive. And for me, that means stepping out on a limb, like I did when I started my nonprofit, taking those risks, not being afraid to live a little, And I think that that's really the stage of life that I'm in, is I just want to live. I want to like go on adventures. I want to do crazy stuff, risky stuff, not super risky stuff. I'm not jumping out of a plane. I've done that. but just, I want to, I've already had a less than ordinary life, but I'd like to do it from the opposite perspective. I'd like it to be less than ordinary from like a positive perspective, not just because there's this horrible thing that's happened.